Good day, everyone. This is Dr. Soper here, and today I'll be discussing the foundations of artificial neural networks and deep Q learning. If you're unfamiliar with Q learning, then I would recommend that you watch the earlier video in this series entitled Foundations of Q Learning before watching this video. Before we begin discussing the foundations of artificial neural networks and deep Q learning, let's briefly review what you'll learn in this lesson. By the time you have finished this video, you will know what artificial neurons are, what activation functions are, how neural networks work, how neural networks learn, what deep Q learning is, and how deep Q learning works. Once we understand all of these concepts, we'll be fully equipped to start building some AI models that rely on artificial neural networks and deep Q learning. Let's get started. Before we can understand artificial neural networks and how they work, we'll first need to learn about artificial neurons and activation functions. So, what is an artificial neuron? Well, artificial neurons are the elementary building blocks from which all artificial neural networks are built. They were first proposed by Warren McCullough and Walter Pitts in 1943 as a mathematical model of biological neurons, which form the basis of all animal brains, including the human brain. It was these biological neurons that served as the primary inspiration for the artificial neuron model. As shown in this diagram, the purpose of an artificial neuron is simply to transform one or more input values into an output value. Each input value is multiplied by a weight, the effect of which is to adjust the strength of the input. For example, if the input value is 0.8 and the value of the weight is 0.5, the result after multiplying these two values together would be 0.4. In this scenario, the weight would have served to reduce the strength of the input value. If the value of the weight had been greater than 1, then the strength of the input value would have been increased. After the weighted input values have been calculated, they are run through an activation function in order to produce the artificial neuron's output value. Finally, note that the values of the weights can be adjusted during training in order to minimize error. We will return to this idea in a few minutes. Next, let's learn about activation functions. In brief, an activation function is simply a mathematical function that an artificial neuron uses in order to transform its weighted input values into an output value. As shown in this equation, the activation function takes just one input value, which is calculated as the linear sum of each input value multiplied by that input value's associated weight. Put differently, this equation tells us that we just need to multiply each input value by its associated weight and then add all of the results together in order to get the single value that will be passed into the artificial neuron's activation function. Let's learn a bit more about different types of activation functions. It's important to note that many different activation functions can be used in an artificial neuron. Each activation function behaves differently with respect to the way that it transforms its input value into an output value. To better understand this idea, let's consider these four activation functions, which are among the most common types of activation functions used with artificial neurons. In this first example, we see what is called a threshold activation function. The threshold activation function returns one of just two possible values, 0 or 1. When the value passed into the threshold function is greater than or equal to 0, the function returns a 1. Otherwise, if the value passed into the function is less than 0, then the function returns a 0. The output values for artificial neurons that use a threshold activation function will therefore always be 0 or 1. This next activation function is called a sigmoid activation function. The output of the sigmoid activation function will always be a number between 0 and 1. Positive input values will yield output values that get closer and closer to 1.0 as the size of the input values increase. Conversely, negative input values will yield output values that get closer and closer to 0.0 as the size of the input values decrease. Again, the output of the sigmoid activation function will always be a number between 0 and 1. The third activation function is called a hyperbolic tangent activation function. the hyperbolic tangent function is very similar to the sigmoid activation function, except that it will always yield an output value between negative 1.0 and positive 1.0. Thus, positive input values will yield output values that get closer and closer to positive 1.0 as the size of the input values increase, while negative input values will yield output values that get closer and closer to negative 1.0 as the size of the input values decrease. This final activation function has become very popular in the past few years and is known as the rectified linear unit, or ReLU, activation function. For input values that are less than or equal to 0, the ReLU function will simply return a 0. For input values that are greater than 0, the ReLU activation function simply returns the output value itself. Thus, output values from the ReLU activation function will always be between 0 and positive infinity. Before proceeding to the next topic, let's revisit our artificial neuron diagram so that we can be sure that we understand the big picture. Remember, the basic process is that the sum of the weighted input values is passed into an activation function, which yields an output value. The nature of the output value will depend on the specific activation function that is being used. For example, if we're using the sigmoid activation function, then we know that the output value will always be between 0 and 1. Finally, note the important role of the weights. When we were learning about activation functions, we saw that the output value always depends on the input value. Since the values of the weights directly affect the input value, the weights also therefore affect the output value. This idea will be important when we learn about how the values of the weights are adjusted. Now that we're familiar with artificial neurons and activation functions, let's learn about neural networks. Put simply, an artificial neural network is an interconnected collection of artificial neurons that are arranged into layers. In the example depicted in this diagram, the neural network contains three layers: an input layer, a hidden layer, and an output layer. Each of the circles or nodes in the figure represents an artificial neuron, while each of the arrows shows how information flows through the network from one node to the next. Remember that there is a weight value associated with each of these paths. As you can see on the diagram, the outputs from one layer become the inputs into the next layer. Keeping in mind what we've learned about artificial neurons, this means that the output of an artificial neuron can become the inputs into other artificial neurons, with each interneuron connection having its own weight value. Now let's consider these layers in a bit more detail. To begin, the input layer consists simply of the values for each input, or predictor variable. These variables are often called features. The artificial neurons that comprise the input layer typically do not have an activation function. This simply means that the values for each input variable are passed directly to the artificial neurons in the next layer without being transformed by an activation function. Next, note that an artificial neural network can contain what are called hidden layers. Such layers are called hidden because they are not visible outside of the model. Put differently, when viewed from the outside, we know what the input values are, and we can see what the output values are, but we have no knowledge about how those inputs are actually converted into the outputs. This information is hidden inside the hidden layers. Finally, the output layer contains the neural network's predictions, which are often referred to as labels. And that's it. As you can see, neural networks are not actually as difficult to understand as many people seem to think. We just take some input values, multiply them by some weights, and then run the results through an activation function. This yields output values that are then multiplied by more weights, and then run through the activation function in the next layer. The process is repeated until we reach the last layer, which is the output layer. Now, for those of you who are familiar with linear regression, I would like to make a very interesting point here. Specifically, note that a neural network with no hidden layers and just one node in the output layer is conceptually identical to a standard linear regression model. Without any hidden layers, we make predictions simply by multiplying each input value by a weight, and then summing the results. I hope you'll agree that this connection between neural networks and linear regression is quite interesting. Next, let's talk about how a neural network learns to transform input values into predictions. The big picture view is that a neural network learns by repeatedly considering a set of input values and trying to predict their corresponding output values as accurately as possible. This means that we need to provide the neural network with many examples of input values with known output values in order for it to learn. Neural networks therefore rely on supervised learning. From a more detailed perspective, the way that a neural network learns is by iteratively adjusting the weights for all of the nodes in the input layer and the hidden layers, with a view toward minimizing overall prediction error. Recalling the role that the weights play in determining the input and output values for each artificial neuron, we can now understand how adjusting those weights can cause the neural network's predictions to change. Each iteration of the learning process proceeds as follows. First, beginning at the input layer, one or more sets of input values is passed through the network, yielding one or more predictions. This is called forward propagation. Next, we measure the amount of error in the predictions. Working backward from the output layer toward the input layer, the neural network next uses the information about the prediction error to adjust the weights in such a way as to reduce that error. This is called backpropagation. During the backpropagation process, the weights themselves are updated using a method called stochastic gradient descent, or one of its many variants. Finally, after all of the weights have been adjusted, the process is repeated using the next set or sets of input values. This training process continues until we either run out of training examples, or until the average amount of prediction error becomes sufficiently small. And that's all there is to it. You now understand how a neural network works, and how neural networks learn to generate accurate predictions from a set of input values. Next, let's learn about deep Q learning. For this part of the video, it will be useful to recall what you learned earlier in our Foundations of Q Learning video about states, actions, rewards, and Q values. So what is deep Q learning? Well, deep Q learning is simply a combination of Q learning and what is known as deep learning. The term deep learning is being used more and more frequently in the artificial intelligence and cognitive computing community, but it's really not as complex or intimidating as many people might believe. After all, a deep learning model is simply a neural network with multiple hidden layers. Thus, if you were to take the simple neural network that we discussed earlier and add one or more additional hidden layers, you would have created a deep learning model. Recalling what you learned earlier in this series about reinforcement learning in general, and Q learning in particular, in deep Q learning, the inputs into the deep neural network are the states of the environment, and the outputs are the set of Q values for each action associated with the input state. In deep Q learning, we're thus using the neural network to predict the Q values rather than using the Bellman equation. Just as in regular Q learning, in deep Q learning, the AI agent will usually take the action that has the largest Q value. We say usually rather than always because, just as with all reinforcement learning methods, we need a mechanism that encourages the AI agent to explore its environment. I'll explain exactly what this mechanism is in a few moments, but first, let's talk briefly about the outputs of a deep Q learning neural network. As with any neural network, in order to train our deep Q learning network, we'll need to provide the network with examples of inputs and outputs so that it can learn. In deep Q learning, the targets of an input state, that is, the outputs of the neural network, are the Q values associated with each possible action for that input state. The Q values, as always, are our current predictions of the sum of all future rewards that we would receive if we were to take each action. These Q values are computed using part of the temporal difference formula. As shown in this equation, the target value that the deep Q learning network is trying to predict for each possible action for the current input state is equal to the sum of the reward received from the action taken in the previous state, and the largest Q value available for any action in the current state multiplied by the discount factor. As with regular Q learning, the discount factor, gamma, provides us with a way of discounting future rewards. Finally, let's return to the issue of exploration. In deep Q learning, we encourage the agent to explore by using what is called the softmax function. Remember the exploration-exploitation dilemma that pervades all of reinforcement learning. The AI agent needs to explore its options in order to identify how each option might influence the agent's goal of maximizing its total rewards. This means that it cannot always choose the action that appears to yield the greatest reward. Instead, the AI agent will occasionally need to take actions that appear to be suboptimal at that moment in time in order to try to discover new paths or approaches that may yield greater overall rewards in the long run. When applied in the context of deep Q learning, then, the softmax function converts the set of Q values for a state into a set of probabilities for each possible action that can be taken in that state. The softmax function thus yields a probability distribution for our Q values. The action chosen by the AI agent is then determined by taking a random draw from the probability distribution that was returned by the softmax function. In this way, the AI agent is most likely to take the action that appears to yield the greatest reward, but it will occasionally take actions that currently appear to be suboptimal in order to try to discover new information that may yield greater overall rewards in the long run. Now that we have a good understanding of the principles of artificial neural networks and deep Q learning, we can begin to create some sophisticated artificial intelligence models that rely on these technologies. In the next video in this series, we'll see how neural networks and deep Q learning-based AI can be used to create a self-driving car. We will definitely be getting a lot of practical, hands-on experience in creating an AI model in Python in the next video, so I hope you'll join me as we continue our adventures in cognitive computing and artificial intelligence. Well, my friends, thus ends our lesson on the foundations of artificial neural networks and deep Q learning. I hope that you learned something interesting in this lesson. And until next time, have a great day.